afternoon, friends. So I'm going to tell a story which is a slice of life from my industry, that is the film industry. So I thought I can educate you about, you know, the little quirks and, you know, the idiosyncrasies of that industry. And this is a story within a story, okay. So first, this is the story of a producer, say let him be Mr. Narayan, okay. He is a very successful producer of films. He has made about 50 films, and he was sitting in his room, probably double the size of this room. And he had a neat table, and there is a PC, and he's working on that, marketing strategies for his next film. And here there is a big cupboard where there are lots of shields and awards, no, whatever he has got in his productions. Okay? So there is a knock on the door, and a young boy, he just peeps in, says, "Why are you coming without knocking? Aren't you seeing that I'm busy?" But somehow the look on the young boy's face makes him a little more patient and, you know, affectionate with him. He says, "What do you want?" So that person, his name is Arjun, he says, "I am an assistant director, sir, producer, sir. Can you give me some 10 minutes to narrate a story? And I have worked in these films, I have worked as AD in so many of the films," and he gives a list of films. And they are all very good, impressive films. So this producer is a little anxious, and he's a little inquisitive, what story this person has to say. And he's a little, actually to be very frank, the look on the assistant director's eyes, no, makes this producer think, "See, I am very good at judging people. I can judge people how they tell stories and whoever has talent and potential. So let me hear this man's story." But at the same time, he was a little afraid. In case he tells a boring story, then he has to conceal his yawn and things like that. So he just calls, he tells him, "You come and sit now." Then he calls, takes up the telephone and calls his co-producer who is sitting in the next room. Says, "See, there is a person here, a young boy. He seems very promising. Why not? He wants to hear a story. Why not we hear the story?" So the co-producer also comes to this room, and both of them sit very comfortably, and they give a seat for that assistant director. The assistant director, actually he sits on the edge of the chair, you know, because usually they will want to narrate, they want to act, you know, they want to have so many emotions, like our storytelling. So usually they have the habit of telling a story like that. So he just sits on the edge of the chair. So this is the setting for the story. So now I'm going into the story. So this story is about two young boys. You know, they are about 10 years old. So the story starts on the platform of the station. And a young, very poor boy. We can find out that he's very poor because he's dressed in tatters. He has a very torn bag with him, a cloth bag, and there are some torn papers. So probably he is a school boy. That is what we understand. And he is limping and going. So, but why is he limping? Then when we just find out, it looks as if his slippers are torn. He has a very tough time walking. He's just dragging his feet along. And the platform is quite empty because his train hasn't come. And this boy's school is on the other side and of the platform, and every day he walks through. But today what has happened is the slippers are so torn that he's finding it very difficult. And we can see the frustration on his face. So he goes and sits on the platform, and he's so angry with his mother. Every day he has been asking his mother, "Please buy me a pair of slippers. And I'm finding it so difficult to go to school. My friends are making fun of me. But you're not buying me." But the mother is working in a tea shop, you know, as a maid, washing these dirty vessels. So she says, "I'll get you a pair, but please be patient. Let my boss come from his tour, then I will get you. I'll get some advance money and get a slippers for you." So this boy is convinced, you know, he knows the situation in his house, and he's convinced, he's very good at heart, you know, basically. So now he waits in the platform, trying to find out how he's going to reach to the school without his slippers. So, and this boy loves slippers, and, you know, generally we have, when we don't have something or yearn for something, we are always focused on that, and we see that only, you know. So he's always looking at people at their feet only, what slippers each one is wearing. So his eyes are always focused on the feet of anybody. He doesn't even look up to anybody. So as he was looking like that, he finds a bright pair of shoes, black shoes, polished shoes, walking and coming. So then what, he's so happy seeing the shoes. They're so bright and nice, and he feels so happy about it. Then he just tilts his head and finds out who is wearing that. And it's again another boy, same age, and a very nicely combed, nice looking boy with a good t-shirt and all that. So, and he is walking with his parents. And that boy goes and sat, because they're all waiting for the train, he goes and sits in the platform, and the platform bench, and he starts polishing his shoes. So this little boy is thinking, already his shoe is so bright and nice, why is he going on polishing it? So that boy also has a love for the shoes. That is what the boy starts thinking. Then that time, you know, the train comes slowly and then it stops. And suddenly you find the platform is filled with people, people coming in and out of the compartment, rushing in to go and all that. So this boy is just focusing only on the pair of shoes, you know, that legs and the pair of shoes. So that boy starts to board the train with his parents, and suddenly, because of that crowd pushing that side, say, one of the that shoe just slips and it falls down. But the boy has already got into the compartment and he is helpless. If he wants to just get down and get his shoes, but there are a lot of people and he will definitely miss the train. So this poor boy sitting, he just watches it. And after the, and then the train starts speed, and then slowly there is nobody in the platform. And there is this lone shoe lying there. And the lone shoe seems to tell it to this poor boy, do something about it, do something about it, I am lying here. So this boy starts running, picks up the shoe, and by this time the train is moving a little slowly, because in the compartment, in the platform, it is just moving slowly. He picks it up and runs fast, and while the other fellow, the other rich boy, is just peeping out, handling, catching the railing of the compartment and looking out in disappointment that he has lost his shoe. His father is saying, don't worry, I'll get you another shoe, don't worry, don't bother about it, it doesn't matter. But this young boy, this poor boy here, he just takes the shoe, runs, and then he says, I'll give it to you. The other boy says, okay, come, give it to me. So this he runs fast, but because he's a very small boy, he's unable to pick up that much speed. He just throws the shoe, thinking that it will go and land in the compartment. But unfortunately, it hits the window and then just falls outside and a few yards away from him. So the other, the poor rich boy actually thinks what to do. Then suddenly he has so much of presence of mind, he just picks up his other shoe and then throws it back on the platform. This young, this poor boy is just frozen. No, he just looks at that. He doesn't know what to do, just to pick up the shoe and give it back to him, or is then he realizes that the other boy has done it for himself. The shoe is for me. So okay, then he takes up that, he runs, he picks up the other shoe, takes both the shoe and waves to that boy. That boy so happy, he says like this, keep it. And then he says, so the story ends like this. So the assistant director says, this is the story for a short film. And this is a visiting card for my talent. Allow me to do it, sir, and then you will see how big a film I can do. So first, this producer and this co-producer both have heard the story. They are really impressed of the goodness of the characters and the way the boy narrated and all that. And then the story, the co-producer says, see, everything is fine, all that. But see, nowadays, you know, this stories with small boys as heroes, I don't think they are much of commercial importance. So why not you change the two boys characters to older men characters? Then the producer says, yeah, that's a good idea. And not only that, see, both are very good. Nowadays, goodness does not sell at all. One has to be really bad. So give some negative element to one character. That is only better. So the co-producer says, correct, that's a very good idea. And so why don't you make the poor boy a bad person? See, because something has happened in his life, he's not even able to buy a pair of shoes. So the society, he must be very hurt. He must be a person who is taking revenge on the society. So why don't you change his character like that? And the producer says, no, that is all right. But also the rich boy, you know, he must be a haughty person. Why should he be kind to this person? So like this, on and off, these two people were discussing so many changes in the story. So this assistant director, he just stood up and he said, thank you very much for listening to my story. And now I know how many awards and shields you got. Now I know how you have got it. Thank you very much. And just makes, you know, goes out of the room to just search for another producer. Thank you.
It's an Egyptian film.
So I added this thing.
Oh, lovely.
So you made a story out of it.
I heard your real time.